I would like now to go with you through what we call the criteria that allow us professionals to define this disorder. You may know that basically as a psychiatrist and professionals in mental health, psychologists and so on and so forth, we when we studied this condition, we have some manuals which set out some criteria that help us in terms of diagnosing this condition. Now, you may have heard that there are different classifications of mental conditions. So basically, there are two big important classifications in our field. The first is the ICD, International Classification of Diseases. This is by the WHO, the World Health Organization. And it is a classification of all the medical conditions, including the psychiatric ones and mental conditions. I will start from the other one for the reason that I will explain in a moment, which is the DSM. You may have heard of it surfing on the internet. So DSM is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorder, and it is from the American Psychiatric Association, but it has become quite influential outside America. So according to this classification system, there are a number of criteria that we use to diagnose the conditions. And this is helpful because it allows to have a standardized way to diagnose in psychiatry. So when we look, we open the book with this, which is this one, there are a series of criteria that needs to be met in order to diagnose ADHD. So the first one is that we need to have six or more symptoms of inattention and or, and I would like to stress this, I will be back to this later on, symptoms of hyperactivity or impulsivity. The number is five in those 17 years old or older. So basically, this book provides a list of symptoms or problems, such as, I don't know, difficulty paying attention when doing homework, difficulty with organization, and so on and so forth. So we have a number of problems. And the first thing to, in terms of the diagnosis, is that we need to provide evidence that the child has at least six of inattentive and or hyperactive impulsive symptoms. And also they need to have persisted for at least 6 months. So why at least 6 months? This is to indicate the fact that ADHD tends to be quite a long-lasting condition. So there are situations where, for instance, following loss of somebody in the family, following a traumatic event, children may display with, you know, problems of attention, concentration, but this is not ADHD. This is due to a reaction to the traumatic event, which oftentimes is temporary. So by contrast, ADHD tends to be quite a long-lasting condition. So the limit of 6 months was a convention in a way, but to indicate that it needs to be something that lasts for a certain amount of time. Also, these problems need to be inconsistent with the developmental level of the child. So I'll give you an example. I was working a long time ago in France, more than 15 years ago, and I was called, I remember one evening, by a mom who was very worried, and she wanted really a consultation as soon as possible for her child, because she was very concerned that the child could have ADHD, because the child could not focus and was moving a lot, much more than, you know, other children. When I asked the age of the child, she told me 11 months. So of course, we need to put this into context. It is normal for an 11-month-old child not to focus for more than, you know, a couple of minutes on something. So we really need to think, are these symptoms in line with what we expect based on the developmental level of the child? Also, in order to be considered for a diagnosis of ADHD, these problems need to lead to an impairment. They need to impact the daily functioning of the child and the family. We have a number of cases where basically it is clear that these children display some of these problems, but overall they function quite well. Now, is it because they are overcompensating and, you know, family provide a kind of scaffolding, or is it because really they have these characteristics but they can cope with them? So in this case, we don't think that we need to rush in terms of, you know, providing a treatment or labeling these problems. Now, you may think, why do I need at least six or more symptoms? Why six and not four or five or three? Now, let me explain these with these figures. So basically, the thing is that when it comes to attention, concentration, motor activity, levels of impulsivity, it is not a black or white thing. So it's not that there are children who are hyperactive and children who are not hyperactive. It's not that there are children who are inattentive and children who are not, you know, who are able to pay attention. So it is actually a scale of gray. So if we look, we take, you know, 100 children randomly from the population, and we look at them, some of these will display very high levels of hyperactivity, some moderate levels of hyperactivity, and some they will not display hyperactivity at all. So the thing is that we are talking about something which is along a dimension. But so how, what do we do to say, you know, you have ADHD, you have something that needs to be treated, and you don't have something that needs to be treated? So we need a threshold, we need a cutoff, and this, based on a number of previous studies, has been established as six symptoms. Now, if you want, it is something very much like blood pressure and hypertension. So if we look at blood pressure, it's a continuum. But when do we need to treat somebody for hypertension? We need a cutoff. Now, in the case of ADHD, this has been established based on the number of symptoms. Now, this makes sense. So it makes sense to have a cutoff. The issue is that, unfortunately, the current way we have to diagnose ADHD is not probably the best one, because the number of symptoms may be misleading. So actually, if you look at this definition, if you think, if a child has seven symptoms of inattention and zero of hyperactivity or impulsivity, this child will receive a diagnosis of ADHD. If you have a child with five symptoms of inattention and five symptoms of hyperactivity and impulsivity, basically, this child, according to this criteria, will not meet the threshold. And unfortunately, I have seen this happening in a number of services where children with a clear impairment were denied access to care because they didn't meet the threshold based on the number of symptoms. So I think that it's good to have a threshold, but the threshold should not be on the number of symptoms. Should be more on the level of impairment. So clearly that child with five and five is likely to be more impaired than the child with seven symptoms of inattention. So once again, we need to be careful and look more at the level of impairment, the needs, rather than counting in a very pedantic way the symptoms. I wanted to look together with you at the other criteria that we have in this manual, but without, of course, going in the detail, because I'm aware this is a training, a general training, but I think it's important that we understand the other criteria that are listed in the DSM. So the first is that several of these problems, they need to be present before the age of 12. Now, this is not a magic number. The sense of this is to say that it is something that starts quite early in the development. Used to be 7, but now it's been pushed to 12, but you know, the sense is because some parents couldn't really remember if the children had symptoms before the age of 7. So, but the sense is really to say we are talking about something that starts early in life. If you have a person who has always been okay, and then they start presenting problems of attention concentration at the age of 60, for instance, well, you don't think immediately of ADHD. It's more likely that this person present with, a neurological condition, early dementia or tumor. There is now a controversy as to whether there are cases of late onset ADHD, but this is still controversial in the scientific community. So for the time being, I think it is safe to assume that ADHD is something that needs to start early in life. Also, and this comes to what I mentioned earlier on. So it's something that is present in more than two settings. You may remember that in the case of Matt, the description of the symptoms was present in a home and a school. Now, what is the sense of this criterion? So the thing is that if a disruptive behavior is present just at home, we may think that rather than a neurodevelopmental condition, a disorder of the brain as ADHD is, the child may present with some problems which are reactive to something that is happening at home. While a disorder of the brain such as ADHD manifests itself in different environments. So the other criterion is that there should be clear evidence that these symptoms leads to an impairment, as I mentioned earlier, to they impact daily functioning. And finally, and this is very important for us as professionals when we diagnose this condition, we need to make sure that these problems are not better accounted for by other conditions. For instance, if you think somebody who is depressed, they will present with problems of attention concentration, but this is not due to ADHD, it's due to depression. So it is our job as a professional to understand what kind of condition underpins these problems. So these are basically the criteria of the DSM, and there is an important aspect that I would like to highlight, which is related to the so-called presentations of ADHD. So what does it mean? According to the definition I provided, as you may remember, let's go back to it. So 6 or more symptoms of inattention and or hyperactivity impulsivity. So this means that actually we may have different types of children with ADHD. There are some children who have mainly problems of inattention. We call them ADHD inattentive presentation. This is something that in the past used to be called ADD, and some people use still this term, but it is really outdated. It's from previous classification. Other children present mainly with problems of hyperactivity and impulsivity. So this is the predominantly hyperactive impulsive presentation. Other children have both. So this is the combined presentation. So inattention, hyperactivity, impulsivity. Now, in the past, these used to be called types of ADHD. Now we call them presentation because types evoke something which is more static. Actually, what we saw is that this is quite, this changed over time. So some children, they may start with a combined presentation when they're young, so they have all the symptoms of inattention, hyperactivity, impulsivity, but then over time they may switch to another type of presentation, for instance, the inattentive. So actually, it doesn't make sense to have different types of ADHD, because this can change over time. So now we prefer to use ADHD for everyone, but we specify what kind of presentation they have in that particular time point in their life. I wanted also to briefly mention something, guys, which is in a way related to this, which is called a sluggish cognitive tempo. This is not yet included in current classification, but it's something that researchers are investigating quite intensely now. And basically, this refers to those children who are very inattentive. They dream, you know, they say, you know, they are in another world. They are not at all hyperactive. If anything, actually, they are very quiet. And also they tend to present low level of arousal, so, you know, almost to fall asleep during the day. So we don't really know how we should classify these. Is this a type of ADHD? Is a kind of inattentive presentation? Other researchers think that this is a kind of specific learning disorder. Others, they say, you know, is another problem, we should have another label. But in any way, I think it's important to be aware of this, because we do see these children, and for the time being, I think we tend to label them as ADHD inattentive or ADD, but probably they may have different characteristics.